we've been talking a little bit about the student improvement and feedback process. And there's actually another important improvement and feedback process to consider, which is that of us as instructors and our courses as a whole. And so if we draw, I'm just going to reproduce the student diagram where we had a student going through this feedback cycle that we just talked about. And I'll label this a student. Then another important piece to consider is, this is us as instructors, I'll label us I. We have our own feedback process where we're trying to include, and so we have our own feedback process where we're trying to improve our instruction as a whole. And we can think about assessment as lying along a spectrum of providing information to us as instructors to improve our course as a whole, and to that of students to improve their own personal learning processes. And so if this spectrum is who is the information for, most assessments lie somewhere in the middle. So you can imagine things like homework sets or oral presentations. These are important assessment items that students can use to get some information to improve their learning process, but we'll, through grading homework sets or listening to oral presentations, we get a lot of information about student ideas in our course that we can use to improve our course as a whole. But there's certain types of assessment items that might fall more might fall more along one side of the spectrum or the other. In particular, at the student end of the spectrum, there's things like peer feedback. In this module, we'll get to hear about a case of students who give feedback to each other on homework problems. And as instructors, we don't get a lot of information about what's going on with students when they're just giving feedback to each other, but this is still a really important part of students' learning cycles. And then for us as instructors, you can think about end of semester research-based surveys. And in that case, there's little information that students will actually get out of it because we don't hand them back or grade the students on them. But they're really important for us as instructors to understand our instruction and to improve it. And so we can really think about assessment items as really falling along this entire scale of who's the information for. Is it for the students? Is it for us as instructors? And oftentimes it's going to be both. So you've already heard a little bit about the idea of summative and formative assessment, and assessments of both of these types will be peppered throughout most of the videos that we're seeing in this module. And we also only have so much time, so we won't be able to talk about all of the possibilities out there, but there's so many cool things. And so to give you a little bit of a taste of the diversity of assessment ideas out there, one of my colleagues, Sarah Wise, did a nice job of listing through some of the possibilities. So we'll hear from her now.
But depending on the learning goal that you're trying to meet, you have a really wide range of summative assessments to choose from. If you're talking about having students recall or show their comprehension of information, or to apply information that they have learned about to a new situation, multiple choice exam items can all be written to those levels, as well as to the analysis sort of oriented learning goals. If you're talking about synthesizing or evaluating it as your objective for your learning goal, then you're probably looking at assessments that involve writing short answers or writing essays, so comparative and contrast essays, argumentation essays, and then some of my favorite types of summative assessment are ones that use some of the new technology. So you could have someone have to do all the thinking of an argumentative essay, but perform it in front of the class as an oral presentation, or as a more creative version of that, such as a poem, or an interpretive dance, which I have seen. And you can also have them use the very available video technology and editing technology to make short YouTube videos. And then you can get into really fun things where students vote on their favorite summative assessments and share them through their social media and things like that. Posters and poster sharing sessions are also a really amazing way of students sharing their summative assessment work. In our department, we have a joint poster session between four different upper division classes. Students pick a research topic, they work on that in groups typically, and they follow a certain rubric in order to put together their poster, and then students and instructors go through the poster session, discussing the posters with each other and filling out the evaluative rubric at the same time.
So I really love the final poster presentation idea, and I've actually done that myself in a lot of the courses that I've taught. And I also have a colleague who teaches a general relativity graduate course at Berkeley, and he does this cool Wikipedia final project where students have to create a Wikipedia page about a concept in general relativity. So there's just so many cool ideas out there, and I really encourage you to get creative in your assessments. So given that there's just so much out there, where do we start? Well, it's often likely in STEM that someone's going to hand us kind of a traditional textbook and some lecture notes, and it can be a little overwhelming to take on a course for the first time. So we're going to start with examining traditional assessments and how we can modify and make those better.